Minimal surfaces in NIL, which is Heisenberg group. Okay, so maybe first I will recall what is NIL. So NIL, it is a Lie group, it can be viewed as a group of matrix, but we will not use this representation. What we will use is the following. We will consider NIL to be R3. With the following metric, ds square equals to dx1 square plus dx2 square plus 1/2 of x1 dx2, sorry, x2 dx1, minus x1 dx2, plus dx3 square. So in other words, with the notation e kappa tau that we used last week, NIL3 is e of 0, 1/2. Okay? So kappa is 0, so it means that we have the fibration pi from E3 of 0, 1/2 to R2. And the Bandmann curvature tau is 1/2 E. So as I said, this is a normalization here, because in the general case, you have E3 of 0 tau with any non-zero tau. But if you apply a global homotacy to the metric and a kind of change of coordinate, then you can always choose tau to be equal to 1/2. So without loss of generality, we can always assume that tau is 1/2. Otherwise, it's a homotacy of the metric. Okay. So what will be important for us is the existence, and we will use the Lie group structure to construct the Gauss map of minimal surfaces. So first, we will introduce what is called the canonical vector field, the canonical frame, sorry, E1, E2, E3. So E1 is ddx1 minus x2 over 2 ddx3. E2 is ddx2 plus x1 over 2 ddx3. And E3 is ddx3. So this is what we call C, the vertical vector field. So what are the properties of this canonical frame? It is orthonormal. It's an orthonormal frame. And it is also a left invariant frame. It's left invariant and orthonormal. Okay. So, also it's important to recall what are the isometries of NIL. So if I consider the isometries that are in the connected component of the identity, then they are generated by four families. So isometries that are in the connected component of the identity. So are generated by the following families. So first, we have x1, x2, x3 mapped to s1 plus c, x2, and x3 plus c, x2 over 2. So c is a real number. Then you have the analogous formula translating x2. So x1, x2 plus c, and x3 minus c x1 over 2, c in R. And you have also the vertical translations. So here, they are just Euclidean translations. And you also have rotations. And if you look at rotations around the x3 axis, then what you get is simply the Euclidean rotations. Cos theta x1 minus sine theta x2. Sine theta x1 plus cos theta x2 x3. Okay, so these are the rotations. So you have rotations around any fiber, but it has this expression only for the rotation around the x3 axis. If you consider the rotations around another axis, another vertical axis, then the expression is more complicated. You have to do the composition with a translation like this. Okay. So these are the families of isometries that generate all isometries lying in the identity component. And you also have another component. The isometry group of Knill has two connected components. So the one generated by this. And to the other one, you have to compose all this with, for instance, the rotation of angle pi about around the x1 axis. If you consider the following isometry, so this gives an isometry also of Knill. Okay. So now, what we are going to do is to try to find some properties of the Gauss map of minimal surfaces in Knill. So recall that what Pablo told in his last lecture last week is that CMC 1/2 surfaces in H2 cos R possess a harmonic map taking values into hyperbolic plane. And an interesting property of CMC 1/2 surfaces in H2 cross R and minimal surfaces in Knill is that they correspond one to the other by the sister correspondence, the Lawson type correspondence. These are two examples of critical CMC, critical constant mean curvature. So since we have this harmonic Gauss map for CMC 1/2 surfaces in H2 cross R, we want to find also a harmonic object for minimal surfaces in Knill. So the problem is the following. So since CMC 1/2 surfaces in H2 cross R have a harmonic map, harmonic Gauss map into H2. So this is a result of Fernandez and Mira. So do minimal surfaces in Knill also have a kind of Gauss map like this? Okay, the answer is yes. And actually, the Gauss map is very simple because it is just the Lie group Gauss map. So what is the Lie group Gauss map? Okay, so I consider a minimal surface. I will consider a conformal minimal immersion, x, from sigma to Knill. So sigma is a Riemann surface. So x is a conformal minimal immersion. And I consider its normal unit vector field. Locally. Okay, so a priori this is something that takes value in the tangent bundle of Knill. But Knill is a Lie group. So we can identify all tangent space with the Lie algebra just by left multiplication. By left multiplication, we identify Tx of nil to T0 nil, in some sense. So what we get is a map taking values in the unit sphere of the Lie algebra, because it has norm 1. So we identify Tx nil tree with the Lie algebra of nil by left multiplication. So what we get? It's a map, n hat, from sigma to S2, where S2 is the unit sphere in the Lie algebra. Okay? And then we apply the stereographic projection, and what we get is a map which will take value in the Riemann sphere. So let psi from S2 to the Riemann sphere, C bar, which is C union infinity, so be the stereographic projection for the South Pole. So we define G to be C composed with n hat from sigma to C bar, and we call this the Gauss map of X. Okay, so this is the definition. Another way to think about this is to use the frame E1, E2, E3, the left invariant orthonormal frame. So what we do is we write the vector n. We consider its coordinates in E1, E2, E3. So I write this into brackets to mean that these are the coordinates in E1, E2, E3. And so since the E1, E2, E3 is left invariant, the map n hat is simply the map whose coordinates are n1, n2, n3. And then we apply the classical formulas for the stereographic projection. And we can write the following. So this is also 1 over 1 plus modulus of G2 times twice the real part of G, twice the imaginary part of G, and 1 minus G2. Okay, so this is the definition of the Gauss map. So the theorem that we have is that this Gauss map G is harmonic. But we have to be careful about what it means, because here, harmonic for H2, I mean. Here, this Gauss map takes value into the Riemann sphere. Okay? What we will consider is when is it true that the Gauss map takes value into the unit disk of C? Saying that modulus of G is strictly smaller than 1, by this formula means that N3 is positive. And saying that N3 is equal to 0 means that the modulus of G is equal to 1, and N3 is negative when the modulus of G is greater than 1. So it will be important to notice this. So observation. N3 positive means that modulus of G is smaller than 1. N3 equals 0 means that modulus of G is equal to 1. N3 negative means that the modulus of G is greater than 1. So what does it mean? N3 is n times the vertical direction. So recall that when we have Riemannian fibration, we have a natural notion of graph. Something which is a local graph, something is a local graph, a surface is a local graph if it is transverse to the fibration, if it is transverse to the vector xi. So a surface will be said to be a local graph if N3 does not vanish on this surface. Okay? So in the case where we have an entire graph, it is when the surface is a local graph and also the projection is surjective. So saying that G is never equal to 1 means that sigma is transverse to xi, which is E3. Means that it is a local graph, or local multigraph. Okay, so now we'll state the result about this Gauss map. So first, if sigma is minimal, then G satisfies the following equation. One minus G2 times G ZZ bar plus 2G bar GZ GZ bar equals zero. And we also have a formula for the metric of the surface. DS2 is given by this formula, 16 times 1 plus G2 square over 1 minus G2 4 GZ square DZ square. So this is the formula. So what does it mean? Imagine that you have something which is transverse to xi. Then, after a change of orientation, you can assume that the normal points up. So what you get is a map G satisfying this condition. So your map G takes value in the unit disk, D. And in this case, this equation is simply the equation of harmonic maps with a hyperbolic metric. So remark, if G is less than 1, which means that G takes value as a unit disk, then this equation is the equation of harmonic maps into D with the hyperbolic metric. So now the converse. Well, the converse says that if you have a map from sigma to D which is harmonic for the hyperbolic metric, and if GZ does not vanish, then you can recover a minimal immersion such that G is a Gauss map of this immersion. So it's what we call the Weierstrass-Kenmutsu formula. It's like the Weierstrass formula for minimal surfaces. If you have a minimal surface in R3, then you have its Gauss map which is holomorphic, and you also have, the Gauss map is meromorphic, and you also have a holomorphic one-form omega. And conversely, if you have G and omega, then you can recover the minimal immersion by some integral formulas. So here it's the same. The difference is that we don't have a holomorphic object, we just have a harmonic object. But in this case, we just have one object. There is no omega in the case of minimal surfaces in nil. In R3, you have two objects, you have G and omega. in nil you just have g, because actually the what would be the equivalent of omega can be recovered in terms of g. So it's a big difference between minimal surfaces in R3 and in nil. So, second assertion, if G from sigma to D is a harmonic map for the hyperbolic metric such that GZ does not vanish, then we can recover a minimal immersion X such that G is a Gauss map of X. And moreover, it is unique if we fix the initial condition. In other words, it's unique up to translations. Not rotations, up to translations. Okay.
Sigma is a Riemann surface?
Yes, sigma is always a Riemann surface here. So I consider a harmonic map for the hyperbolic metric, G from sigma to D, and I assume that GZ does not vanish. Then we can recover a minimal immersion such that G is a Gauss map of X. You have some formula, and if you write X to be FH, then you have formula FZ, which is something in terms of G and GZ, and HZ is also something. It's quite complicated formula, but it's some integral formulas. If you have G, you have to integrate some equations, and then you get the minimal surface. It is the same spirit as the Weierstrass representation for minimal surfaces, or also some Kenmotsu type representation. For example, if you have a harmonic Gauss map into the sphere, then you can recover a CMC surface into R3. And also, you can, if you have a harmonic Gauss map into H2, you can also recover a CMC surface in Minkowski space. And you have some formulas by Akutagawa and Nishikawa, which are the same type. Okay, so a few comments about this. What happens if I have a solution of this equation, but taking values in the whole Riemann sphere? Maybe we have some problems when modulus of G is equal to 1, because here the equation becomes singular. So it is a case that can happen. But in some cases, we can have something which is not a singularity. We can have just a surface that is vertical, that is tangent to the fibers at these points. You have to look actually at this metric. If you have a map G taking where modulus of G is 1, you can have several things. Maybe you can have a singularity here. But maybe not. Maybe this is a well-defined metric. And in this case, you can extend the surface. You can recover a whole surface from a map taking value in the whole Riemann sphere. And we will see an example later of catenoids. But in the case where G takes value in the disk, then what you get is actually a graph, a local graph, because N3 is always positive in this case. So the problem maybe is when modulus of G equal to 1, you have to look if this metric here is well defined at points where modulus of G is equal to 1. And if it is the case, then you can extend the surface. And if it's not the case, what you have is some part of the surface going to infinity, something diverging. Or maybe you can also have a branch point if this quantity is 0. So here, GZ does not vanish. This is to ensure that the metric is not singular. In the case where modulus of G is never equal to 1, then we have a metric if and only if this does not vanish. So this is a criterion to have not a branched immersion, but a true immersion. Okay, so why is it interesting, this Gauss map? It's very interesting for two reasons. First is that the theory of harmonic map into H2 is quite well developed, and so we want to, we will expect to find some properties, to apply some properties of the theory of harmonic maps to minimal surfaces. And another important fact is that actually what we get here, the hyperbolic metric, is something that has more symmetries, more isometries than what we can expect. What do I mean? We have a four-dimensional isometric group in NIL, but three of them are translations. And translations in NIL actually are just multiplication, left multiplication for the Lie group structure. So it means that if I apply translation to a surface in NIL, it will not change the Gauss map, because the Gauss map is left invariant. Now, if I apply a rotation to the surface, well, for the Gauss map, what we will get is a Gauss map composed with a rotation about the origin, because the origin here in D means the vertical direction. G is zero here means that N points up. So if I apply a rotation to the surface in NIL, I will apply a rotation around the origin here. Okay? But now, here, I can also apply an isometry to the Gauss map. I can apply an isometry to the Gauss map. For example, a translation. And if I apply an isometry to the Gauss map, an isometry, a hyperbolic isometry, then I also get a harmonic Gauss map. And that, if I integrate the formulas, I will obtain another surface. But this surface does not come from a trivial deformation. It does not come from a congruent surface of the first one. Because the congruent surface, congruence in NIL, they only induce here rotations around the origin. So if I apply here an isometry which is not a rotation around the origin, what I get is another surface, a very different surface, and generically it's not at all congruent or isometric to the initial surface. So this is an interesting fact. We have more isometries here than the ones coming from ambient isometries. And this will be very important because we will try to integrate explicitly some Gauss maps by the technique of separation of variables. So now I will give some examples. So you have some very simple examples, which are vertical planes. So vertical planes is something which is a Euclidean vertical plane, but it is also a minimal surface. So it's something like A x1 plus B x2 equals 0, something like that. So it's a vertical plane. It's minimal. So what is the Gauss map of this? The Gauss map is simply a constant vector. So G is constant, and modulus of G is equal to 1 because the surface is vertical. It's always tangent to the vertical direction, so the vector, the unit normal, is horizontal, and so what you get is a constant with modulus equal to 1. Now another example is surfaces x3 equals 0. The surface x3 equals 0 is a rotational surface. Around the x3 axis. It is not invariant by translations. And it has no other notable properties apart from the fact that it is minimal. It's not flat, it's not totally geodesic. So for this one, G is simply Z. Okay, G of Z is Z. And it is of hyperbolic conformal type. You only have to consider the domain where it is of modulus smaller than 1. Because in this case, if you apply the Weierstrass formula for this, you will have divergence at points where modulus of z is 1. Another example is when the image of the Gauss map is a geodesic. So I have a geodesic here. So a geodesic is a particular case of harmonic map into H2. So this gives a harmonic map which is singular everywhere. It depends only on one parameter. So G is a geodesic of H2. So what we get is the following surface up to isometries. What I get is the following surface, x3 is x1, x2 over 2, plus a constant c times arcsinh x2 plus x2 square root of 1 plus x2 square. So here, this formula gives a surface which is invariant by translations, by a one-parameter family of translations. Okay, and C is zero only for the geodesic that goes through the origin. Not all the geodesic give the same surface by the remark that I explained before. If you apply an isometry here, it gives different surface. And the one for C equals zero is when the geodesic goes through the origin. The origin here means points where the normal points up. Okay. Something I forgot to say is that here, if you take a linear equation, x3 equals ax1 plus bx2, then actually it is the same surface as this one up to a translation or rotation. So it is the same Gauss map. Now you have helicoids. So helicoids, the Gauss map is the following. It's a little bit complicated, but I mean, no, it's not very complicated, but it's not immediate like this. It's when you have a separation of variables like this, where phi is a real function, and satisfying an ODE, and when A is a non-zero real number. So this gives the helicoid. So the helicoid is exactly like in R3. I mean, the helicoid about the x3 axis is exactly the same as in R3. And what is interesting here is that it is conformally hyperbolic. Because the solution of this ODE is not defined on the whole R. Sorry, there is a square here. It's defined only on a finite interval. Now you also have catenoids. So the Gauss map of catenoids is a little bit complicated. It is something which is in the associate family of this Gauss map. So I will not write it. I will just mention that there exist catenoids and what they look like. By catenoid, I mean rotational catenoids. It looks like this. But the difference between this catenoid and the Euclidean one is here that the function is linear. It has linear growth. It's not a hyperbolic cosine as in R3. Okay, so these are the basic examples of minimal surface. So now, what we want to do is to try to construct some more difficult examples and to try to obtain some theorems with them. So the purpose will be to obtain a half space theorem. And for this, we will need to construct some other annulus, some other minimal annuli, which will be properly embedded by different from these ones. These ones are also hyperbolic conformal type. Alors, sorry, I'm speaking French. So, what we will use is to try to integrate explicit Gauss map using a separation of variables, because we have this hyperbolic metric. So we will consider first the following harmonic map. G of U plus IV will be sine phi of U plus I sinh alpha V over cos phi of U plus cosh alpha V, where alpha is positive and phi is a real function satisfying an ODE like this. So phi actually is something like that. Phi is linear plus periodic. So this is a harmonic map into H2. So what is the geometry of this Gauss map? Well, first, we can look at the curves U constant. So I'm drawing D, identified with H2. And if I look at the curves given by U constant, for U equals 0, I get this geodesic here. And for the other ones, I will get equidistant curves. And now if I look at the curves given by V constant, then for V equals 0, I get another geodesic here, orthogonal, the real axis. And for other V constant, I get other geodesic orthogonal to this. So this is the Gauss map. So in fact, remember that if you have a minimal surface in H2 cross R, a conformal minimal immersion into H2 cross R, then its vertical projection gives a harmonic map into H2. And conversely, if you have a harmonic map into H2, then you can recover a minimal immersion into H2 cross R, such that it is a horizontal projection. So this, the minimal surface corresponding to this is one of the minimal surfaces constructed by Laurent, which is something foliated by curves of constant curvature. What you get here is a minimal surface such that each level curve is a curve of constant curvature in some H2. So this is the geometry of this harmonic Gauss map. So in some sense, these are the most simple examples of harmonic Gauss map, other than the one that will give some translation or rotation invariant examples. So now we integrate this. So it's a computation. And if we do this computation, what we will get is an interesting surface. It's something which is a kind of helicoid, but which is not the screw motion helicoid as the first one. So what we get, the corresponding minimal immersion, our first observation is that this formula actually defines something taking value in the whole Riemann sphere. We can extend this across this circle here, across this circle at infinity. And in fact, we have a map which is defined, which takes value in the whole Riemann sphere. So maybe we will have some singularities for this surface or some ends. But it turns out that no, this surface defines, this Gauss map, sorry, defines a surface, which is a helicoid type surface. It means that it can be written like this. X3 over X1 is a function of X2, where F is periodic. So it means the following. If I draw the X2 axis like this, and I consider X2 equal constant planes, then what I get is a straight line going through the origin. So what you, and this is periodic. So what you have to imagine is like a kind of helicoid, but with a horizontal axis. But it is not a real helicoid in the sense that it is not invariant by screw motions. It is just a surface such that in each vertical plane, the intersection is a straight line. And these straight lines turn like this. And you have a helicoidal type surface. So the idea now, if you want to construct an annulus, will be to try to find a Gauss map that is conjugate to this. And to integrate. So now find properly embedded minimal annuli. Other than the catenoids, and the rotational ones. So what we consider is the following map. Complicated, the formula. So alpha is positive. I will consider a real number theta. And you have some ODEs. And also some ODE for beta. Like this. With beta of 0, 0 and phi of 0, 0. So what is this Gauss map? It is conjugate to this one. I mean, not for the same alpha, but this family of Gauss map here and these families of Gauss map, some of them are conjugate. It means that if you have associate, sorry, not conjugate. And when you have a harmonic Gauss map, what you can do is the following. If you have a harmonic Gauss map, G, then you can write dg dg as q dz square plus something mu times modulus of dz square plus q bar dz bar square. So this is the Hopf differential of the harmonic map, and saying that two harmonics are conjugate means that they have the same mu, and that their Hopf differential differ by exponential of I theta, 2i theta. No? So this is the meaning of associate harmonic maps. In fact, we can check that these families here and the one in the other families are associated like this. No? So there are some natural candidates for finding catenoids, because catenoids and helicoid have conjugate harmonic maps. So we have to integrate the equation. But the problem here is that what we get is not a catenoid, it is something simply connected. So we integrate the equation. And so we get an immersion, minimal immersion, x from sigma to nil. So the problem is we want to find an annulus. So we want to close a period. It's a period problem. In other words, we want to find a complex number z different from zero, such that for all z, x of z plus big Z is equal to x of Z. If we found this, we have an annulus. And it turns out that we can find this. For every positive alpha, there exists theta such that we have this property. It's a period problem. So it is, it's essentially some complicated calculations. I mean, it's not so complicated, but it's some computations. And we have to study some integrals depending on parameters and showing that there is some parameter for which some integral is zero. No? This is the idea. So for each alpha positive, we find theta such that z exists. So this means that we have a one parameter family of annuli. So this is a theorem. I forgot to mention that this is a joint work with Laurent. So the theorem is the following. So there exists a one parameter family of minimal, of properly embedded minimal annuli, C alpha, such that we have the following properties. So first property, C alpha intersection with x2 equals C is an embedded convex closed curve. Second property is C alpha is properly embedded, I also said. So C alpha is invariant by rotations of angle pi around the x1, x2, x3 axis. And also, we have that the x2 axis is contained in the interior of the annulus. Yes, they are complete. the complete and properly embedded.
No information about the
quadratic. Infinite.
About the index.
The index, I don't know. It's I guess it's one, but. And it is parabolic. Actually, the curvature has not a sign, does not have a sign. You have some points going to infinity where the curvature is positive, and some other points going to infinity where the curvature is negative. And if you compute the integral of the absolute curvature, it's infinite. It doesn't seem clear if there is a good notion of finite total curvature in nil. It's not very clear. Because one could think also of the area of the Gauss map, but in this case it's infinite area because it covers the whole hyperbolic plane and it also goes beyond the disk. Okay, so if you intersect what this catenoid look like is the following.
If the error graph quadratic?
I don't know. Good question. I never tried this. So it looks something like that. So here you have the x2 axis. And if you intersect with a vertical plane like this, what you give is a convex curve looking like this. And the more and more you go to infinity, the less and less it looks like a circle in some sense. Okay, so I think I will stop here for today. And so tomorrow I will see how to apply this to obtain the half-space theorem. We will prove that this converges to a vertical plane, a double cover of a vertical plane with a puncture singularity. And so this will give us a half-space theorem. And then I will I will study complete graphs. Okay, thank you.